Brother Paul Vaughn is before us again to speak. As I said last night, he's married to Ricky Jett back in 1973. She's with us. We're always glad to see her. And they've spent their life basically in mission work, working with small congregations. He is somewhat retired. Is that better than saying nearly or partially?
It doesn't matter.
Okay. Anyway, he is somewhere around retirement or something like that, working with the Ship's Bend Church in Centerville, Tennessee at this time. He's going to be bringing the lesson on the fatal error on 1 Corinthians 13, verses 8 through 13. We look forward to hearing him. Brother Paul, come speak to us.
I know that within my lifetime, and I'm probably one of the youngest ones in here, and I know I could have went all night without saying that, Brother Doug, that within my lifetime, I've not seen the Bible under attack by the way it is today. Men have no respect for God. Men have no respect for His Word. But if you think about it, the Bible has been under attack just about since the beginning of time, or God's Word been under attack since the beginning of time. Did not Satan tell Eve that God didn't know what he was talking about? You shall surely not die. Genesis chapter 3 and verse 4. And that lie has been growing. That lie has been festering to today. People can think they cannot pay attention to this book and have eternal bliss in heaven. That is fatal error. That is fatal error. Today, we need to go back and we need to look at the words of the prophet Jeremiah and boldly proclaim, as he proclaimed in his day, "Thus saith the Lord, stand in the ways and ask for the old path where the good way is, and walk in it, and then you will find rest for your souls." Brethren, we need to be proclaiming those old paths. And I've never seen a time in the church when people are turning their back on the restoration principle as it is today. But just like the Jews in Jeremiah's day, people today are saying, we will not walk in it. We're not going to pay any attention to that. Our leaders are down in Christianity. The very Democratic Party published 4 or 5 years ago that they view conservative Christians as the American Taliban. Now, I got that documented. I don't know the spot right now, but if you want to, I'll mail it to you. And that's the way it is today. But if we look at the error, the fatal error in the church at Corinth, and see how Paul had to address these things, and how Paul, through the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, spoke to these people. If you look at the first four chapters, they had the problem of carnally minded Christians. Paul said, "I plead with you, brethren, that you all speak the same thing, that there be no divisions among you." Do we have carnally minded Christians today? I'm talking about the Lord's church. I know the world out there is carnally minded. Yes. And I became a Christian about the time when people say, "Well, you can go anywhere, go to Church of Christ, hear the Bible preached." Not so today. So speak the same things. And Paul addressed that. And then their tolerance of sin in chapter 5. Paul said, it's actually been reported that you allow a man to have his father's wife. Why, not even the Gentiles do that. Do we have that problem today? Now, thank God, I don't know of any in the church that has his father's wife, but I wouldn't put it past them. I do know of a preacher or an elder in a church in, say, West Virginia that had five sons, and he used their wives as his wife, and the church put up with it. But how many churches today will say, you have your neighbor's wife, and you don't belong. She doesn't belong to you. They're not addressing divorce and remarriage. Is that not the same attitude, the worldly attitude that Paul was addressing here? And then they went the law against one another. They perverted the Lord's Supper. They got in arguments. And then Paul came and says, let me teach you a better way. Let me teach you a better way. Though I speak with the tongues of men and of angels and have not love, I become as a sounding blast and a clanging cymbal. And then he comes down here to verse 8. And we want to read verse 8 through 13. Open your Bibles. This is such a marvelous chapter in the whole Bible and what Paul is teaching us here. And read along with me. It says, love never fails. But whether there are prophecies, they will fail. Whether there are tongues, they will cease. Whether there is knowledge, it will vanish away. For we know in part and we prophesy in part. When that which is perfect has come, then that which is in part shall be done away. When I was a child, I spoke as a child. I understood as a child. I thought as a child. But when I became a man, I put away childish things. For now we see in a mirror dimly, but then face to face. Now I know in part, but then I will know just as I am also known. Now abideth faith, hope, and love, these three. But the greatest of these is love. Now people have been twisting God's word. So it should throughout time, and it should not surprise us today, that they will take the passage that we just read and they will twist it to their own destruction. What is Paul speaking about? He's talking about the permanency of love. And he is also teaching in this section, he contrasts the temporary with the permanent. The temporary with the permanent. Temporary being the miraculous, the miracles. These things are just temporary. For it relates to the incomplete. Incomplete because all of God's word has not been revealed at this time. 2 Corinthians hadn't been written at this time. Revelation hadn't been written at this time. Other books have not been written at this time. And he says these temporary things, and he looks at them as childish things, the very infancy of the church, are here for a purpose, but they're going to serve their purpose when that which is perfect has come, and they will cease to be. They're going to stop. It will be no more. Paul plainly teaches that miraculous gifts in the beginning of the church were temporary and not meant to be permanent, period. Miracles, tongues, knowledge, all miraculous gifts would end when that which is perfect has come. Verse 10. The church today is built on the word of God. Jesus said, he that rejecteth me and receiveth not my word is one that judges him. The word I've spoken shall same for judge him in the last day. John 12 and verse 48. What's the Lord teaching us there? Pay attention to my words. Read them, study them, know it. Because one day you're going to be judged by them. Not going to be judged by tongues. Not going to be judged by the miraculous. You're going to be judged by my words. Faith is established by this book, the New Testament. Faith cometh by hearing. Hearing by the word of God. Romans 10, 17. Well, Paul, what are you saying? Well, you got to read it. We got to teach it. We must preach it. And when people hear it and believe it, faith is established. I was talking with Michael after lunch and talking about their lectureship coming up. It's going to be on type and antitype in June. And that is such a marvelous study because it is faith building. As studies of prophecies is faith building. If people's faith is faltering, it's not because the foundation is not here for us to build on. It's because they don't know enough of the foundation to build up their faith. So faith comes by hearing, hearing by the Word of God. Therefore, Paul could say to Timothy, all Scripture is given by the inspiration of God, and is proper for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness, that the man of God may be complete, thoroughly furnished into all good works. Well, Paul, what do we need? This. This is nothing else. It'll make you complete in your knowledge of God. It'll make you complete in your knowledge of the Lord. You can go back and read about the prophecies of the coming Messiah, and that'll build your faith and make you strong. You can go back and see the prophecies of the coming kingdom. And knowing that there is one kingdom, one church, and the pattern for us here in the book, and that should make us strong. And be bold proclaimers of the truth, standing firm in God's word. God's word will produce the right worship. God is a spirit, and those who worship him must worship him in spirit and truth. If we want to learn how to worship God acceptably, we just go to his word. God's word will produce the right Christian character. Now, I know some of us are characters, but that's a different subject altogether. But God's word will produce Christian character. Christian character. Well, let's look at some error. And I'm not going to address it all. In fact, I'm basically going to just look at about three things. And when David assigned me this, I tried to get into his mind, and he won't let me there. And I tried to look at some things that we would face on a daily basis that perhaps we would not think about. I know there are scholarly things and all this to get into, and that's fine. People do a good job, but I'm just an old common preacher looking for old common ways to look at God's word to get us to heaven, to refute the error that is out there. First, we must understand that men will twist the scriptures. I truly believe that there are some people in the church believe that people will not twist the scriptures. At least that's the way they act. They act like that everyone is, that we're all loving each other and everything is the truth, and you just accept everything everybody says. But the Bible says in Proverbs 30 and verse 6, and we read this last night, do not add to his words, lest he rebuke you and you be found a liar. Peter, writing about Paul, said, untaught and unstable people twist to their own destructions, as they also do the rest of the scriptures. They twist it. They do everything to it that they can to try to justify what they want and what they believe. Brethren, it's extremely dangerous to try to speak where God doesn't want us to speak. And we need to have the attitude of the writer of Psalms 119, and in verse 136, he says, rivers of waters run down my eyes because they keep not thy word. It breaks my heart when I see people playing with God's word, not keeping God's word, stretching God's word to mean things that it's never intended to mean. Because I know people are going to lose their soul. They're going to lose their soul in this. In Psalm 119, verse 140, your word is very pure, therefore your servant loves it. Oh, let us cultivate a love for this book, that we want to spend more time with it, that we want to make every effort possible to know as much Bible as we possibly can. And I have no doubt there's some preachers in here probably forgotten more Bible than I know. But I'm still trying. I'm still trying. Well, fatal error in teaching that prophecy still exists today. In fact, in the liberal set, now I'm talking about modernists, they said there is the non-cessationist, and these people teach that prophets are still in existence today, and then there are cessationists, and they deny that prophecy continues today. That's the way they describe things. The word perfect is misinterpreted to advance fatal error of the modern day prophets. Verse 13, 1 Corinthians chapter 13, verse 10. Now when that which is perfect has come, that which is in part shall be done away. One of the champions advancing modern day prophecy is a man by the name of Dr. Wayne Grudem. He's a very dangerous man. Rather than anybody that twists the scriptures is a dangerous person, whether they be a man or a woman. Very dangerous person. He has degrees. He has bachelor's degree, master's degree, doctor's degree. And he's educated himself out of any common sense. Now, I believe in Christian education. I'm not against that at all. But brethren, I know some peoples in the mountains, some preachers in the mountains of eastern Kentucky who have no more than eighth grade education, know more Bible than a lot of these guys that put PhD behind their name. Because they've lived the Bible, they've studied the Bible, they know their Bible, they've had to defend their Bible in the world around them, so they worked at it. Well, Dr. Wayne said, we find a definite statement about the time of the cessation of perfect gifts, such as prophecy. They will be made useless or pass away when Christ returns. And this would imply that they will continue to exist to be useful for the church all through the Christian age, including today, right up to the day when Jesus returns. Now, if you put a peg on that statement, he's not implying it, he's flat out saying it. That the miraculous, especially prophecy, continues until Jesus returns. About 4 or 5 years ago, I wrote a review, and David published it, on the English Standard Bible. And I've read it. We read it through. We like to read the Bible through in a year, and that year I read this, and Ricky, we looked at other translations, and we compared it. And as I was getting into it, I thought, well, you know, that's not bad. I got this down at Bellevue, Michael. I'm going to put it off on him. No, I'm glad I got it. And I said, this is not bad. Because I'm always for an accurate modern language Bible. You notice I preface accurate. And as I was getting through the Old Testament and got into the New Testament, something began to change. You realize that this book here has about 17 or about 7 complete verses that are minus 7 complete verses that this book has. And there's about 21 or 26 verses where the partial of the verse is not in there that is in this book. And when I wrote that review of it, you could not find anyone who was on the translation committee or the oversight committee in the translation of this English Standard Version. I say this because this is a dangerous Bible because it's not accurate, and our brethren are jumping on this, you know, like a dog on honey, I guess. They just lapping it up. And they're that way with the NIV, some of them. And they're always wanting something new come along, and they just jump on this. But in doing my research for this lesson, I run upon this Dr. Wayne Grudem, and he is on the oversight committee for this Bible. Now, I've already quoted that he believes that prophecy still exists today and will exist at the time of Christ's return. Do you think that he would probably translate that into this? Well, you know he does, or I wouldn't have brought it up anyway. I mean, why bring up something that doesn't mean anything? For he says here in 1 Corinthians in chapter 13, verse 11, and I yellowized it for you, so if you want to look at it, you can, but not right now. Wait till I'm getting done. And when the perfect comes, then the partial will pass away. Not when the perfect should come. He says, when the perfect comes. So he's changing that word from what is put forth in this book. He says here, but when that which is perfect has come, when the perfect has come, and he's translated his prejudice, he's translated his fatal error into this Bible. How many average Christians could look at that and realize what took place? They're not going to pay attention to that. In fact, they probably compare it to them and say, oh, don't they say the same thing? They don't. They don't say the same thing. Paul's instructions in 1 Corinthians is simple to be understood by everyone who uses good exegesis. Now, exegesis means simply to take God's word and read out God's message. When the perfect, he says, when that which is perfect is come, that which is impartially done away with, he's talking about the New Testament. When the New Testament is complete, then the miraculous is going to end. The miraculous is going to end. Well, the word perfect comes from teleos, and it simply means complete in various applications of labor and growth and mental and moral character. It is neuter in the Greek, completeness of full age. Well, now in 1 Corinthians, Paul uses this word, this Greek word, twice. Here in 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 13, when that which is perfect has come, that which is impartial be done away with. If you turn your Bibles over to chapter 2 in verse 6, however, we speak wisdom among those who are mature. The New King James translates that word mature, yet not the wisdom of this age, nor are the rulers of this age who are coming to nothing. Now, if you take those two words and see the meaning, it's exactly defined the way Strong's defined it. That which is complete. Teleos is used two times. And thus, when we come down over here, it cannot mean, according to Daniel Denham, where is Daniel at? There he is. He says it cannot mean Christ. It's not there in the Greek. It has to mean something else. Has to mean the Bible. What is perfect? This. Well, I know Jesus is perfect. God's perfect. Holy Spirit's perfect. But what we can have our hands on and open up and look and read this right here is perfect. Verbally, plenary, inspired. So we see pompous individuals with over-educated minds taking their prejudice and putting it in a translation. Brethren, if you don't know you have an accurate translation, you're being living very dangerous with your soul. Because you can have a Bible and read it and study it and live up to it, but if it's inaccurate, you're following fatal error. You're following fatal error. Now, let's look at some other things. The dangers of translations is easily seen in the English Standard Version. What about study Bibles? When we talk about error being taught on certain subjects, have you ever thought about study Bibles? Now, I'm going to say something that might make some people mad. That's all right. You're not going to be the first. You won't be the last. Study Bibles are an oxymoron. Now, that's a contradiction in terms, isn't it? They're an oxymoron. Their interpretations clearly pervert the Bible. Now, I have this Bible, and it's a New King James translation, and it's a study Bible, and it was given to me and a member of the church, and he just didn't know how to teach him. He says, you take this Bible and give it to somebody, and they could use it. Well, when he gave it to me, I didn't pay attention to what it was. I laid it down and got around to it, looked it up. I said, it's a study Bible. I said, well, let's see the notes. In 1 Corinthians in chapter 13, verse 10, he says, that which is perfect has come. The Greek word for perfect means end or completion. And that's correct. And that which is complete is done. Most likely, this is a reference to the second coming of Christ and the completion of all things. Most likely, this is talking about the return of Christ and then the completion of all things. But some have interpreted it referring to the completion of the New Testament canon. They kind of vacillate around a little bit. But their strong statement is that prophecy exists until the time of Christ return. Now, last night we talked about on baptism, especially Acts 2:38, and I just thought I'd just throw this in too. I mean, might as well. I got here, and David's going to make sure I use all my time. In Acts 2:38, now notice what they said here when he talks about 2:38. He says, when a person recognizes who Jesus Christ really is, the result is a desire to do what Jesus commands. And I hope that's, you know, people recognize who Jesus is. You want to do what he says. Now, the first action that Jesus requires of a new believer is baptism, an outward expression of an inward faith. The ideal of an unbaptized Christian is foreign to the New Testament, but for the remission of sins, saying that we must be baptized to receive the forgiveness of sins, Scripture clearly teaches that we are justified by faith alone and not by works. What gets me sometime in Bible study, someone will have something like this, and I know what they're doing. They're reading up here, and they're coming down here seeing what I say and comparing what this says, and they want to impress me by how much they know. And they come down here and they start reading these notes. Well, I'll be honest with you. Somebody's got a study Bible in class. I already know how much they know. And it's not that much. Because these things, all study Bibles, should be thrown into a pit. And I'm not going to throw this in a pit because I'm going to use it as illustrations in other lessons to condemn it. But all study Bibles should be thrown into a pit and burned so they cannot deceive the simple, the naive, and the lazy. We've come to the point in the world today that we want everything fast and easy. We want our food fast and easy, and we'll satisfy for a substandard hamburger to get the thing in a minute or two. Right? You go to McDonald's, you're not going to get a good hamburger. You might not even be getting beef. But you get it quick sometimes. And that's the way it is with religion today. Isn't it? They want it fast and easy. Not to offend. So that everybody can be happy. And they don't study their Bible. David, how many books did you... You don't have to tell me. Let's put it this way. Did you publish 10,000 books this year? No. Is there not at least the capability within the brotherhood of people, members of the church, buying 10,000 books? Well, there's capability, to be honest, probably of buying 25,000 or 30,000 books. Yeah. Yeah. But if you think about it, people are not buying books because they don't want to study. All right? They're not buying books because they don't want to take the effort behind studying. And this one guy suddenly says, well, I just read the Bible and what it says is what I believe. And I thought to myself, you're in trouble already. Because you don't know exactly what it's saying at places. You have to have resource material. You have to have tools. Right? Tools. This book would be a good tool when studying about the Holy Spirit. It'd be good for every family in the Lord's church to have one, wouldn't it? How many members of the church have some type of religious library? Oh, I got my study Bible. There it is. It's got all I need. And they're lost. The faithful Christian life requires an abundance of study. Study to show thyself, to prove unto God a workman that need not be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. Now, I introduced last night's lesson with saying that it is fatal error not to love God. Because Jesus said, you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind. This is the first and greatest commandment. And if we don't love God, that's fatal error. To love God means that we're going to study about Him. Doesn't it? Does that not mean that I'm going to spend some time at home going through this book? I got this Bible. I got it because it was inexpensive. I tear them up about every 2 or 3 years. I just do. And it's red. Someone says, preacher's got a red Bible. You know what I tell them? It's red every day. It's read every day. So we need to be reading this book every day, laying the word up into our heart so that we can overcome the pitfalls of the wickedness in our society. We need to study God's word. Sadly, they are using the Bible today to advance fatal error, not truth, trying to disguise error in certain translations. Satan is undermining the foundation of the church in the advancement of fatal error about the Holy Spirit. In the advancement of fatal error about baptism for the remission of sins. In advancement of fatal error about the worship of the church. In advancement of fatal error about Christian morality. Somehow, some people got the idea you can do anything you want and God's going to accept it. Not going to be the way. But if you go back to Genesis, in Genesis chapter 3, we see that he hasn't changed any throughout time. And the serpent was more cunning than any beast of the field when the Lord God made the Lord God had made. And he said to the woman, has God indeed said, you shall not eat of every tree in the garden? And the woman said to the serpent, we may eat of the fruit of the tree in the garden, but of the fruit of the tree which is in the midst of the garden, God has said, you shall not eat it, nor shall you touch it lest you die. Then the serpent said to the woman, you will surely not die. God says one thing, the devil says something else, and she believes the devil. God says one thing today. The devil and his servants say something else. And who are they believing? Hasn't changed a whole lot, has it? Brethren, do not let the devil and his servants trick you into believing fatal error. It will cost your soul. Do not let anyone cheat you of your reward in heaven by accepting that which God does not accept, or binding that which God does not bind. There's a narrow path we have to walk. When I was in school, they had this term about hidebound traditionalists. And they were talking about, you know, I guess the Bibles being, at that point in time, they were leather. This is not leather. I don't know what it is, but it feels good. You're bound by what's between the leather. I'm bound by that. I told Ricky, and she gets mad when I say this, that I have to be the dumbest preacher in the brotherhood. I have to be the dumbest preacher in the brotherhood because I'm afraid to go beyond what's in this book. And there is a lot think they can do anything they want and say anything they want beyond what's written in this book. And they call themselves highly educated individuals. So I said, I have to be the dumbest person because I have to rely upon what's in the book. What's in the book? Well, sometimes we can be led astray by others. Sometimes we can be led astray by ourselves. And sometimes we're lost because we just do nothing. I was first encouraged to speak by Brother Clark Elkins. I said, Clark. Clark was a good man. He was one of those preachers that did not have one of those really high formal educations. In fact, it was said that he worked in Michigan on a crane, and at lunchtime, he would take his seat on his crane and take his New Testament and memorize Scripture. I believe he had it all memorized. Gave me my first chance to preach in Mason County, Kentucky on a Sunday night. I thought I had at least a 45-minute lesson. And I did 10 minutes. But I left it in good hands. He got up and finished it. And gave him the 45-minute lesson. But Brother Elkins was preaching for a church in Kentucky, and I don't need to tell you where. It's not important at this point in time. And he's been dead a few years. And there was this person in the congregation that was extremely faithful to every service, but he never obeyed the gospel. Never obeyed the gospel. Can you imagine sitting and listening? I just can't imagine sitting and listening to Brother Elkins and not obeying the gospel. He would blister you at times. You better be paying attention to what's in the book. And the man was a good man. Faithful to his wife, a family man. But for about 15 years, he sat and listened and did nothing. Had a heart attack. Rushed to the hospital. The doctor told him that you only have a few hours to live, and you're going to step off into eternity. He called for Clark and the elders of the church. They came. And when Clark walked in the room, he said, I saw him in bed. He saw us, and he just lifted up his hands, and he says, no hope! No hope! He had no hope! Not because he didn't hear the Word of God, not because he wasn't taught the Word of God, but because he never responded to the Word of God. And he was at a position, if he wanted to be baptized, if they moved him, he would have died instantly. And I think how tragic that would be to lay there in a bed knowing that just in a few moments you're going to die and you're not prepared for that journey. And it reminded me of an illustration, and that was true. This is most likely isn't. back in the time when they had knights and court jesters, this one king wanted to have a competition for the best court jester, and back then they called them court fools, for the best fool in the land. And this one guy became the best fool in the land. And it came up to the king, and the king gave him a scepter. He says, I give you this because you are the best fool in the land. Well, a few years later, the jester heard that the king was dying, and he walked in, and he said, sir, are you prepared for this? He goes, no, I'm not. And then the court fool gave him his scepter back, saying, it is truly foolish not to prepare for that which you know is coming. Are you a Christian? Are you a Christian? Do you believe in Jesus Christ? He wants you to believe in Him. God the Father wants you to believe in Him. I'm taking that extra time. God the Father wants you to believe in Him. He wants you to confess Him before man. And by the way, that's not just a one-time confession. It's a lifetime of serving the Lord. To repent of one's sins, to be baptized for the remission of sins, to live a life of hope. 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 And as a Christian, we should ask ourselves, how much do I love God? Sometimes life gets busy and it comes between us and our God, doesn't it? So easily done. And we don't do what we should, or we don't think what we should, and perhaps we all fall short in that direction. Me probably being the leader of that group. But it would truly be foolish to know what's in this book and to have obeyed it and then to drift away from it. Because that would mean no hope. Do you have hope? If you do, thank God and keep it. But if you don't have hope, now's the time to do something about it. Because who's going to say that tomorrow you might be in a hospital and knowing there's no hope? And you're not prepared. If you need to prepare for the Lord's invitation, it's not hard. You know, the Lord's not asking us to do anything to humiliate us, to embarrass us. He's just saying, if you want to live with me in eternity, do what I say. Come on to me. I'll give you rest. In my Father's house are many mansions. One's for you, if you come, as we stand and sing.